Today we're going to be talking about making income as a composer in a way that maybe you haven't thought of before. And hello everybody, welcome to episode 4 of the Musician Toolkit. I am your host, David Lane. It is great to be with you today. We have a long but very informative episode that I can't wait to share with you. So we're going to get to it very soon. First of all, let me just thank Fonz, our sponsor, and you can find a link to them in the show notes. This is for you if you have a private studio of any kind. It's a free trial. Check it out in the show notes. There are many ways that you can get an income as a composer. Notice I don't say make a living. There are a few ways you can make a living as a composer, and sometimes it involves you being in like the top 1% of a certain group, such as being a film composer, video game composer. There are a few concert composers that can do that. There are some theater composers. But in talking about being a well-rounded musician, there is another way that you can also explore as a composer, even if, you know, you don't say that I'm a composer is the main thing that you do, but it's part of what you do, or it's something that you're interested in doing. It's something you'd like to become better at, because the ability to compose is one of the 20 musician tools that needs to be in your toolkit that you should explore. I'm going to be talking to Bruce Tippette today about composing for commercial sheet music. We'll talk more about what that is, but it's mainly music that would be for education purposes or for religious purposes. It's music that you would publish for church, for choir, for handbells, for school band, for school orchestra. And there's a need out there, and part of the need is that a lot of composers, it's a good thing, but you know, we're always thinking big, and we're thinking about, you know, the big concert stage and the big film score, video game score, being on Broadway. But if you compose, there's a lot of places where you can be used and used well. And what better place than to provide good quality music for young musicians and for those who are in church music ensembles? It's a way to get your music out there for people who need it, and also to generate some passive income through royalties. And as Bruce is going to talk about, sometimes those connections, those relationships can lead to some active income through commissions. Bruce is going to be talking about two of the musicianship tools today that will apply to this whole conversation. And that, of course, is the ability to compose, but also, and we kind of save it toward the end, but business skills, because you have to have a little bit of savviness anytime that you're trying to sell your music, however that goes. But I also want to highlight Bruce as a musician. We've already had this interview that I'm about to present, and I just went through and, you know, just counted some of the tools besides the two that I mentioned that we're talking about. He, in his own life, makes use of piano skills, vocal skills. He has mastery of a primary instrument. He has experience with other instruments. He has knowledge of music theory. He has a well-trained ear, and he has the ability to teach. And I'm sure that there's others that he makes use of, but those are the ones that we talked about. And actually, he also talks about, leading a musical. So that is the ability to conduct. So he is a well-rounded musician who is a full-time musician that is making his income from a variety of ways. And one of those ways that I wanted to talk to him was composing for this certain type of music and getting published and using those connections to get the opportunity to compose on commission. So now, again, going into this episode, you might not say, I'm a composer with a capital C. But if you're listening to this podcast, you know it's important to not shut the door on any of these skills, but to explore it. So have an open mind and just know that this is a way that you might consider adding a little income, building some relationships, and exploring the creative side of being a musician. So we're going to get right to it. This is my conversation that I had earlier with Bruce Tippette. Bruce, thanks for joining me on the Musician Toolkit. How are you doing today?
I'm doing great. How are you?
All right, I'm doing fine. Thank you for being guest number one on the Musician Toolkit, and I'm looking forward to what we're going to talk about today. I guess just as a means of introduction, I want one of the things that I thought about earlier today was how there's very few people in this world when you ask them what they do, that they can be really specific. I think a lot of us can say I'm a musician, and that covers, or I'm a teacher, I'm a music teacher. There's a lot of things that we can do, but it doesn't cover every aspect of your income. Unless you're one of the top 3%, 4% of film composers, video game composers, or if your name is John Adams or John Corleone, if it's someone like that. That can get six figures on a commission
That's right,
and
and
get
they're good
tons
for
of
the year.
royalties. Yeah. But mo you know, that's kind of the idea of this podcast is what if you're not one of those 2, 3, 4% or whatever the statistic is, and you want to make a living as a musician. So, what makes up I like what one previous guest said, it was a income quilt. What goes into your income
Right.
quilt?
Oh, that's good. So my biggest part of it is I'm an educator, and originally I taught high school chorus for a few years, and I took a break, and I went back to school and became a stay-at-home parent, and now I'm back into teaching full time, and I'm teaching preschool and elementary school music, so general music. And yeah, I'm going literally, I've had some people ask me, I'll say, yeah, I work with the babies. They're like, well, what do you mean? I was like, I mean, I have 2-year-olds, like full-on baby. So it's yeah, I go from 2-year-olds through fourth grade, so on any given day I could see all the groups. So that's one piece of it. I'm a church musician. It's funny, my job just shifted. I was a handbell and youth choir director for a long time, and I didn't play a lot during the services. I before that job, I led a Methodist congregation at the piano, but now I have a new job where I'm accompanying, and I'm leading music from either the organ or from the piano. So I've got a rehearsal each week, and then a Sunday morning service, and sometimes I'll have meetings and practice time for that. And I teach private piano lessons as well, before and after the normal school day. The school where I work actually has a really neat enrichment program where I can have the students that I teach during the day actually take it's kind of set up in a tutoring, but they're getting piano lessons. So I have students that come at 7:45 to take a piano lesson, and then I have kids who stay after school to take a piano lesson. And then I'm a composer, and I write a lot of music. Right now, I just finished a commission for a group in New York, and then I've moved. I literally went from one to the next. I'm trying desperately to meet a deadline for a group here in town in Winston-Salem, and I've got 2 more weeks, so that's good. I have a double bar. I've got to orchestrate and put expressive details, but it's I know where I want it to go, so I feel really confident about it. And then I have one more commission for a choral piece that is also, she wants it beginning of February, and all I have are sketches for that. So that's gonna be a whirlwind. Another piece of that, since we're wanting to get specific here, on top of all of that, I have started a musical theater production at the school where I am. It's actually part of my contract is to do the lower school musical, and we just started rehearsals for Frozen.
Oh, nice.
I start in the morning. I have piano lesson, I have school for the day, and then I have, depending on the day, I'll either have piano lessons or I'll have rehearsal for Frozen, and then I'll come home, do some family time, and then I'll try to write some music before the end of the day.
Wow.
So
Depending on how long this goes, I may ask you about like time and energy management because I it takes a certain type of personality, temperament, energy level to work with preschool kids. And I could envision that like zapping you for the day, but you have all these other things that you listed, and that sounds like a challenge.
it is. I think I don't know. It's one of those things where the energy level of the kids kind of feeds me. And certainly when I'm done for the day, I am zapped. And for a long time I used to work weekends pretty heavily, but I don't anymore. I used to teach on Saturdays, and Sundays were more than just like I would have a service and then rehearsals and then other things in the evening, but I don't have any of that anymore. So I do have a little bit of recharge time on the weekends now. But it's certainly a lot. The classes I teach during the day are relatively short. They're about 30 minutes each. And I typically plan, like with the preschoolers, I kind of have a template for what my classes are like. And this is, a lot of my composition comes into that. I had some, like during Halloween, I was like, there's not really a Halloween song that I'm really crazy about, so I'm gonna write them a Halloween song. So I just did a very simple, we're gonna spell the word Halloween and what time is it, and I had some minor chords with it on the ukulele, and they loved it, and we performed it, and it was super fun, and it didn't take a lot of time to write it, but it was a great way for them not only to learn how to spell Halloween, but they had fun doing it, and so they were learning and also having fun, and I got to do something that I wanted to do with them because I ended up writing it for them. So just kind of using all of those skills all together, I find that I do a lot of writing for my students more so than I think I thought I was going to do for them, because I have it at my disposal, And it's great. If something's not working or something, I want something really specific, or I know what their capabilities are, but there's nothing available specifically that I know that they're going to be able to do. I write it for them and make it work,
That sounds awesome. So let's talk a little bit about, just being a composer. In my mind, the ability to compose is one of the 20 tools of musicianship
Okay.
that I've come up with. And I think every well-rounded musician is, they could call themselves a composer. Now, when people call themselves a composer, it tends to mean that they're doing it actively to get their music performed or they're making some
Right.
kind of income from it. But I think there are, there could be people who are doing exactly what you are, but maybe coming at it from reverse. Like they could be being a music teacher is the first and foremost thing that they decided to do, and that's their calling. And through that, like you said, they may start writing some music, and it's just one of many examples. But I wanted to talk to you today because and I want to talk to you just a moment about like what got you into composing and what led you to this path. But you've written music for chorus, handbells, and I was just for string orchestra, for concert band, of course, some chamber music. And I was just looking at your website, just your list, and you've got just some of the publishers that I see on there that I think, especially if you're a church musician or school musician, you might recognize, you're on Hal Leonard, Shawnee Press, you're on Alfred Music. And I mean, those are just like from being a church choir director for so long, it's like those are catalogs that come in. Like the only one that I didn't quite See, and that doesn't mean it's not there's hope music. It seems like those are like the big ones on there,
Yeah.
but you're in that, you're in those catalogs, you're on there, and you've got, looks like quite a ton of choral music and other things. So we're going to talk more specifically about getting into that. But what would you describe this avenue of composing? I think you said it was like, do you call it commercial music or mainstream or?
I like to, I try to explain it to people who aren't in the music world. I say, you know how you go to a band or choir concert at school? Well, someone had to write that music for them. That's where I come in. I write that music for them. So it is commercial print music. It's geared toward the world of education.
And I don't know. I mean, I'm sure there's all kinds of people out there. I'm sure there are people who in high school, they get this urge to do exactly this, and they go to study that. But
Yeah.
if I want to stereotype just for a moment, I have a feeling that you and I are probably representing two of the extreme branches of what you can do when you're studying composition. For me, it was film composing. It's like
Right.
I really wanted to be a film composer, and I had to be talked into writing music that would exist outside of a film. Actually, you want to write with structure in mind. It can't just be one theme, and a development and all that. It's like, but you need to have some structure and you should try this. And I had a great composition teacher who encouraged me to explore all that. And he was one that said, okay, you like John Williams, go try Samuel Barber and
Yeah.
Sergei Prokofiev, go try some of these and explore your worlds. Now we haven't talked yet, so maybe I'm wrong. Maybe you had a different background, but I know, but the other common type of route is the person who kind of sees themselves writing these, Beethoven's lineage, the next great composer writing orchestral music. And I guess if I was to say the next, instead of the next John Williams, the next John Adams, the next John Corigliano or Philip Glass or someone like that. So what got you into composing? What was your initial goal?
Well, that's a big question. So, why don't I start with like what I where I started writing? I was taking piano lessons as a kid, and I had been in I'd been in a choir that had like rehearsals that was outside of school. It was an auditioned group. I was about 10, and there was like a training program that helped the students learn to read and make sense of connecting that with what they were singing. And so I had really good instruction through that, and my sister was taking piano lessons, and I decided, hey, I want to learn how to play piano as well. And I moved really fast through the books, and because that because I mean, I just kind of I inhaled it, I breathed it, and it was very much just a part of what I did every day. And I started to just play around on the piano, do some improvisation, and I went into a piano lesson one day and said, "Hey, I came up with this tune on the piano the other day that I just kind of made it up." And I played it for him, and he told me, "Bruce, you should write that down." I was like, "Well, I mean, what do you mean?" It's like, "Well, do you have some blank composition paper?" I was like, "I do. I had like a spiral bound composition book." And he was like, you should write down the music." I was like, okay. So I was probably 11 or 12, and I went home and I wrote the music on with my I was very methodical. I had these perfectly round note heads, and I wrote this piece. It was like a ragtime style tune. I was probably working on like a piece in one of my books that was that same style. And I guess I was imitating that, but it was, kind of my own tune. And I wrote it down, and he was like, "Do you mind if I borrow this?" I was like, "Sure." So I left it with him, and the next week he had it engraved on the computer, and he printed it out for me. He was like, "This is your music. Print it." I was like, "How did you do that?" He's like, "I used a computer software." And I think it was like Finale version one, maybe. I mean, this was like the late 90s. And I was like, "Is that something that I can do at home?" And I started to kind of play around on my computer with that, and the whole point and click. I didn't have like a keyboard to put anything in, and it was all point and click. And I was in, I we'll go ahead to 8th grade. I had started taking band, and I was in chorus at school, and there was this competition for what was it called? It was like the North Carolina Reflections contest. I don't know if that still exists or not through the school system. And one of the things you could do was write music for it. I mean, it was many different things with performing and visual arts, and composition was one of the things on there. And I had written a piece for a project about The Pearl by John Steinbeck, and I had like these three sections: the good side of the pearl, the bad side of the pearl, and the pearl lying at the bottom of the sea. Like, that was the project. So I had these three little themes on the piano, and my soon-to-be high school band director helped me put it into the computer because my sister was already at the high school, so we knew the music teachers there. And I ended up winning this local Wake County competition writing this piece. And so I just kept writing, and I kept wanting to do more, and I would learn stuff in choir and in high school band. And I would always ask, "Can I borrow these scores?" I was like, "I don't know how to write for a full band, but I bet if I look at these scores, I can figure it out." And at the time, I didn't realize I was doing score study, but I was just like, "Why are the saxophones and the horns always together?" Or, "Why, when clarinets and flutes are doing these runs, they are in octaves." So just kind of learning those ins and outs and thinking about I would never know how high can they go. Well, in this piece, they go this high. Well, I won't go any higher than that because this has been printed. So that's my good range. And so I then presented some music to my, I asked my director. I was like, "Hey, if I write us a piece, could we like perform it or practice it in school?" And they were gracious, and they gave of their class time to let me, work on a piece of mine in class. And during all this time, I wanted to be an architect. Being a musician was not a thing. And both my high school choir and band directors were like, "You need to be a musician, and you should be." They were like, "You should continue to write music," but they knew the ins and outs of the business and what it's like to be a musician. They were like, "You should be a composer, but you should still teach." I was like, "Okay." So I went to school to be a teacher and a composer. I did a double major, and I always wanted to have one of my band pieces published like the band pieces we did in school. So I started just doing some research online as best as I could at the time, of just, like literally clicking on people's bios, and, "Oh, this person's the editor of this publisher. Let me find their website. Where's the contact?" And then reach out to them and see what they say. And I got a contact for Robert Sheldon, who used to be the Alfred concert band editor for forever. And I was in college when I reached out to him, and I was like, I'm an aspiring composer, and I'd love to have my work reviewed for publication. And I started sending him stuff, and I mean, obviously everything I sent him was rejected. I mean, for years.
Right.
And I ended up going back to, I went to teaching. I taught for 4 years as a, I ended up being a choir teacher. I went to school to be a band director. I ended up teaching chorus. But my instrument's piano, so it worked out. And I had choral experience as a child and a high school student. And I started writing for the band there at the school where I was teaching, and just workshopping some stuff. And then I went back to school for my master's and really focused just kind of on my craft and my skill and what I wanted to write and how well to write it. And then I reached out to Robert Sheldon again, and then started sending him some other stuff, and they started accepting my music. I was starting to figure out, what they were looking for.
I just want to ask, since we, hopefully have some composers listening, is there like a single example of something that you could say specifically that once you started doing this or stopped doing this, it made your music more marketable?
The first few pieces that I was really trying to get published, like I wrote this piece to get it published, none of those worked, because it was either the difficulty is perfect, but it's a super boring piece, it's bland, or this is so super interesting, but it's way too hard, and the balance doesn't work. So I just started writing for, like, hey, there's this group, they're going to perform the piece, I'm going to write for them what works for them specifically. And as I was finishing my master's, the group that I had been a part of as a child had commissioned me to write them a choral piece, because I had seen them in person. They were like, Bruce, are you still writing music? Yeah, I'm still writing. I'm finishing up my master's. I'm like, we'd love for you to write us a piece. And I just wrote for them. I knew the accompanist could play great piano, and I knew the voices. They could. I asked him, I was like, how many parts do you want? He was like, let's do three parts. So I did SSA, and I was like, what text do you want to use? And he sent me this Emily Dickinson poem. Hope is the thing with feathers. And so I just wrote it very specifically for them. It was performed, it was well received at the performance, and then they performed it again at what was it, the Piccolo Spoleto Festival in South Carolina. Just and I think at Myrtle Beach. No, not Myrtle, in Charleston. It's in Charleston. And I invited my high school choral director to go to one of the concerts, and she was like, my good friend is friends with the new choral editor at Alfred. You should send it to him. I was like, oh. And it wasn't like I did not write it for publication. I wrote it for this specific group, and I got a good performance. So I sent the piece and the performance saying, hey, this is a piece we did. It was performed, and they loved it. The audience loved it. What do you think? And I heard 6 weeks later that they wanted to publish it. So it was like weird. It's like I ended up writing for group that had asked me versus just kind of writing just to write with the end goal of it being published. And I find this happens a lot, that there are composers out there that come to me like, I want to be published, and what do I do to get published? And usually my advice is write for performances. And if publication happens as a result of those performances, then awesome. But writing just for publication ends up not being your most inspired work. At
Right.
least that's what I have found to be true. Now there are some cases where I've written a piece because a publisher has said, "Hey, we're looking for something this like this," and I have a hole. Would you be able to fill it? And I'm able to provide something. So that ends up being writing a piece for publication. But I had been quite a bit and in the business at that point. So I felt like I knew, you know, every piece you write, you find new ways to do certain things in your music to be, there's a composer, Brian Balmages, that I've worked with. And he said, the goal is to make the music sound more difficult than it is.
Right.
So so like you could write something that is technically easy for the players, but it sounds and performs as if it's much more difficult.
Right.
And that's kind of the way to make it work.
Right.
the X factor. I don't know.
So a couple questions I thought about. What do you off the top of your head, do you know how many pieces you've had published?
Probably 60-ish, 65.
Okay. And you probably don't keep this number in your head, but if you had to make a rough estimate, how many times how many rejections have you gotten to get to that number?
If you take that publication number and then multiply it by maybe about, hundreds,
yes.
but sometimes,
yeah,
I have a piece that is published. Before it was published, it was rejected 5 times, you
right.
know. And sometimes I'll have a piece, and the first place I send it, it gets picked up.
Mm-hmm.
It's so funny. I had a piece 1 year that was rejected, gosh, 6-7 times, and then it finally got picked up by someone and it ended up winning like an award for something online.
Right.
That then put it in a, like, JW Pepper does like an editor's choice catalog where they pick the best of the best for the year, and then it got put in a special catalog. And it's so funny how every publisher is looking for different things. And I had some editors who were like, I just don't think this has any marketability, or this is just not something that's going to work for us. And then someone else picks it up and then it ends up selling really well. So I'm like, it's made me think about, on the other side, these editors, they sometimes they're gambling with what they take and what they don't take. And it doesn't always work out on their side either.
As you've added numbers of pieces to your published catalog, I just wonder, do rejections work on a curve? Has that decreased your number of rejections? Because now people can say, well, others have taken a chance on him and he's doing pretty well. So,
yeah, I have found the rejections have gone down.
Mm-hmm.
But I also, I also know there are certain pieces where I kind of have an idea. I'm like, this will probably work with this catalog or there are some pieces that I know this is way too hard for everyone. Like, I wrote a piece for trumpet, horn, and piano, and it's incredibly difficult, but I wrote it for a friend who was getting his DMA, and he was like, I've got a horn player. He was a trumpeter. I was like, I have a horn player and a piano player, we're all working on our DMAs and we just want something to really sink our teeth into.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, I want to write them something that's going to be great for them. And they made a great performance of there was two movements. They did a great performance of the first movement. And I was like, I don't have anyone to send this to. It's a crazy instrumentation. It's super difficult. I don't know what to do with this. Well, I started getting emails from people because the video was on YouTube. They're like, hey, is this piece available? And I was like, I can make it available. and it sold a few copies, and I ended up putting it on JW Pepper's My Score, where you can self-publish, and it's sold relatively well for a piece that I otherwise it would have just been that one performance. It people have found it because of YouTube. I mean, I can't think of any other reason why. I had the professors at Davidson College. They found that they were looking for North Carolina composers, and they found this piece and they performed it. And I was able to go to the performance. It was awesome. And I, you know, it was a self-published piece. So right. I didn't end up sending that to anyone because I knew it was just going to be rejected because it was too, right. It was a very niche market. But for me, if I can sell 20 copies of that piece, that's 20 more people that have my music in their hands than would have. And it's a totally different market, totally different group of people than who are looking for a choir piece for middle school, you know? So being able to write for just a wide variety of different instrumentations, difficulty levels, and styles and lengths has been just really great for me. That, you know, I could have an orchestra. Like we want, like I last year actually I had a group in Pennsylvania. They wanted a piece for like a grade 0.5 orchestra, which is like the first six notes of a D major scale. or you can use open strings, and they were like, the hardest rhythm we can do is 2/8 notes at a time, and it's got to be on the same note, you know? So it's like super basic.
Yep.
And they're like, and we don't know if we're gonna have string bass or not. So and viola and violin too have got to be the same part, you know? So it's like really thin. And I added a piano part with it. And it's published now. It was just performed at the Midwest Convention last month. And it's like a minute and a half. And I think I spent a weekend writing it, you know?
Nice.
And, you know, other like these, this piece I'm writing for Wachovia Winds, I've spent months on this thing. But it's like a North Carolina grade 6 piece. So it's like fully scored and it's going to be 6.5 minutes long. So, it's a lot, a lot of parts.
You've mentioned some numbers, 0.5 and 6. And I know you may not have like all the details memorized and there's resources online, but just roughly, can you walk us through the grading system that you have to consider with band and orchestra pieces?
Sure. So I was very, I wanted to be clear with saying the North Carolina 6, cause that's different than how like the publisher landscape is.
Right.
So when I send to publishers, they actually want kind of a grade level in mind. And I usually try to tell them, like, I'm gearing toward this level, and hopefully it is. I sometimes miss the mark, you know, so I don't have it perfect. But with band and orchestra, they are on a scale of half levels from grade 0.5 all the way up. Most publishers go up to level 5.
Mm-hmm.
Typically like a grade 6 publisher ready is going to be like a professional group, you know, like the New York Phil is going to be able to do, like, so a lot of John Williams film scores are probably grade 5, grade 6.
Yeah.
It's just professional level. So when we're looking at grade 0.5 for band, typically that is the first 6 scale degrees of the B flat scale. So there's no leading tone,
right?
And rhythmically, you don't do anything more than 2/8 notes. Typically, they're the same note. Sometimes you can get away with doing stepwise motion. You don't want a lot of skips, especially when with 1/8 notes. If you're doing quarter notes, that's fine. And articulations are pretty basic.
Mm-hmm.
You can have some slurs and some staccatos and accents, but that's pretty much it.
Mm-hmm.
You don't want to put like marcato in there or anything like
Right.
that. It's just and really basic dynamics as well. And for band, kind of want to think low scale. What is a group going to have at their bare minimum? And usually they're going to have flutes, clarinets, saxophones, trumpets, and trombones. And then
Right.
everyone else is kind of doubling.
Yeah.
So if you put a tuba part in there, you got to re recognize that it's probably got to be doubling something at the octave below. And it's likely that there's not going to be a tuba part. And because, with grade 0.5, these are beginners. So
Yeah.
it's usually third, fourth, fifth, sometimes sixth grade, depending on where you are in the country.
No contrabassoon then either,
Probably not. Probably not the contra. It might be a little big for those little fingers. Even just regular bassoon, a lot of kids aren't going to be started on the bassoon. So a lot of times with grade 0.5, you have trombone, euphonium, and bassoon just all in the same line, and they all just play in unison. And sometimes that goes all the way through grade 1.5. And it doesn't really split off until you get into grade 2. And as you go up each grade level, typically you start to see voices will split. So first you'll see clarinets split into two parts, and then trumpets split into two parts. And then as you get a little bit higher, you might see the saxophones split into two parts. And then as you get into grade 2, you might start to see tenor sax and French horn can have their own part sometimes, but you might want to cue it if they're by themselves. So just in case you still don't have those parts there, but you can start to give them their own voice and start doing dotted rhythms, and you can expand the percussion a little bit more. And then as you get into grade 3, you can start to see we've got three trumpet parts, three clarinets. You might want to add a piccolo above. And then the rhythmic landscape gets a little bit more complicated. You start adding 16th notes and triplets, and sometimes you can start putting that in the grade 2.5. And then the length of the piece gets more, the number of keys you can use is more. And the way they put it is they put the list of keys, the relative minors, and then you can actually think about using the modes too for those same keys. You can be just basically using those pitches and those scales. Most kids are going to know those fingerings for those scales. And then as you get into like grade 4, it's usually whatever is necessary for your piece. They kind of take out like you can then be a little bit more free to do as you please. And then as it gets more and more difficult, they might put a grade 5 on top of it, depending on how long the longer the piece is and the more difficult it gets, you're going to start to see that 4 become a 5. And it's the same kind of thing for orchestra, except the keys are going to be different. You're not going to start
In B
violins
flat.
in B flat, right? They may want to not ever play the instrument again. So it's the same kind of landscape, with just it's tweaking a little bit with what is necessary for strings and thinking about high and low fingerings. It took me a little bit of time to get more comfortable with the orchestra levels because I never played strings. I played in an orchestra, but I played French horn. So doing string orchestra was a new thing for me, but I've gotten pretty confident and competent in writing for that instrumentation, and it's been great. So a lot of publishers have their grade levels listed on their websites, and for the most part, they're all pretty much the same. You'll find some discrepancies between publishers. And then you have your state levels that are for like their music performance adjudications, and that's a totally different different thing, you know. So a publisher grade level four might be a North Carolina grade six, you know, just based on what that particular piece is. They kind of do it piece by piece and look at the specifics of what's in there. So they have their own guidelines. There's their own palette of what they expect in their music. So you might see the grade levels inflated a little bit per state, you know. And in the Texas, what might be in Texas a grade four might be in North Carolina a grade five. You know, it just depends on what every state has deemed appropriate for their students.
For the standard levels you mentioned, are there grade levels that you get the feedback from publishers that are like they could use more of these types of pieces? I mean, I assume that there's probably not a shortage of level four and five, but I imagine lower than that, because you as a composer, when composing is like the main thing you do, you just want to like just get that music out, and y'all can figure out how to play it. But you have to think differently. So, what are some of the levels that you think have more need, of composers to
I mean,
contribute?
there's definitely three, four, and five. There's usually plenty of that out there. And I've found that it's much more difficult to get a piece published the harder the music is, because A, there's way more music being written in that level, and B, there are fewer ensembles that can perform it. So I found that the grade like 1.5 to 2.5 is a pretty great range of need. And if you look in catalogs, you'll see there's a lot more music being published in the twos, the ones in the twos. And then you get further down in the catalog and you look at the threes, fours, and fives, and there might be like 1.5, maybe two or three fours. And then there's like 15 grade twos in the same catalog for the year. So what I've started doing is becoming more and more familiar with what is acceptable, I guess, or the ability wise that the students can play, but then writing it in such a way that makes them feel that they are, you know, they're creating something that is new and fresh, but within their capabilities that they can be successful. And it's a challenge. It's a lot harder than you might think, because you know, you get to a place where you're like, I can't do this. I can't tie this eighth note to a triplet and then them only play the second and third partials of it. And you know, I've got to water it down a little bit, but you kind of get to a place where you get comfortable with the less is more mentality. And I've found that I write an easier piece of music that I'm like, oh, is this going to be good enough? Does this represent me well? And then I hear the demo recording of it, and it's like, man, this is a really nice piece, and it sounds like, you know, I could hear a more professional group playing this, and it's sounding great, because it to me, I feel like it's a good piece of music. It just happens to be able to be performed by beginners or intermediate students. So I don't like to label myself as someone who writes music for, you know, students only. I just write music that can sometimes be performed by students who are learning their instruments. And so it's still me in those pieces. I don't feel that I'm completely giving up my style or what it is that I have to offer, just because I've decided not to do these quarter note triplets and then a quintuplet right after. You know, I'm doing just a simple eighth note pattern instead. But you know, you can find that you watering some things down, you're still like, it's like the puzzle pieces are put together differently
Yeah.
to get the same result.
Right.
So I have I really enjoyed writing for that those easier grade levels sometimes. And then, you know, when I get the opportunity to write a more difficult piece, like this piece I'm writing for the Wachovia Winds right now, and I can really
Right.
just put it all out there. You know, it's great.
Let's do a little bit of tool talk or nuts and bolts. So
Sure. Yeah, 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 yeah.
I think what you know, if for anybody who's saying, well, this sounds like you know something that I can kind of add to what I do as a musician. Let's first of all, like, what are the skills as a musician you want to develop? So, from what I've gathered from what you said already, I think score study would probably be essential, you know, to find pieces in those levels and see what it looks like, see what the instruments are doing, how high they're going, how low they're going. You
Yeah.
know, obviously just, you know, understanding some basics about composition, you know, how harmony works and so forth. But is there anything else that kind of comes to mind that, you know, this musician can work on to improve, to come up with quality music for these levels?
Oh yeah, I think having your music performed by real players is huge. I know sometimes that's difficult to do. Especially if you're not in school anymore, because you know sometimes the computer it's imperfect, as far as what it's going to really sound like balance wise, and it's still a computer, you know, and sometimes you get kind of tricked into thinking, oh, this is so boring, when in a real setting, you know, you can have a brass choir play a swell and a whole note and then a quarter note and it sound amazing, but then on the computer it's gonna sound boring, you know. So kind of being able to transfer what you see paper or on the computer into what is this gonna sound like in a real setting. And the only way to know how to do that is if you have actually had your music performed. Again, that can sometimes be difficult. So if you're unable to do that, I think having someone who has those abilities giving advice on your music, you know, having a proofreader, having someone look at it, is you know, just something that is invaluable, you know. And also for composers creating or developing a thick skin, because you know, you've got to have the ability to hear, hey, this isn't working, this is why, here's how you can fix it. And then instead of being like, well, that's not how I wanted it, and I'm not changing it for anyone else. And that is a hard lesson to learn, but I have found 9 times out of 10, if I have an editor tell me, let's do it like this instead, it usually is the right decision. I've had a couple times where I've been like, I'd prefer this instead, and usually they're good about it, unless it's like, hey, this is going to be impossible by a group, or you're going to limit who's going to be able to perform this and at what cost, you know. So I have found that, you know, developing that thick skin is kind of essential if you're going to want to improve your skills. And writing for many different types of instrumentations and becoming you know, an expert on all of the instruments, not just the one you play. And I mean, for me, being able to play piano has been just the best. you know, hearing all of the voices at once and singing on top of it. I sing all the time when I'm writing music. My family loves to make fun of when I'm you know, doing a thing with my music. And and being able, you know, I record all the time. You know, when that voice memo app came out on my phone, that's been awesome. I whip it out all the time, do ideas. I'll set it on my piano and play, I'll sing. And knowing that it's okay not to use everything.
Yeah.
You know, sometimes you have to write something out and delete it before you get to what you're going to keep, you
Right.
know? And I just did that with this piece I'm working on for the Wachovia Winds. I had this whole section that I was like, this is the melody, this is how it's going to be. And then I started this other melody, and I'm like, you know what? That's a way more interesting melody. What am I going to do with this other one? And I was like, I'm just going to delete it.
Yeah.
But I ended up copying it and putting it into another file. I was like, maybe I'll use
Right.
it later. I probably won't.
Yeah.
Probably never be used for anything else. But I don't know. Maybe a few years down the road, I might come back to it.
That's true.
But I don't know that I would have gotten to the melody that I'm keeping if I hadn't written the other one.
Right.
So I don't know how well I'm answering
Oh
your
no,
question.
that's excellent. I mean, it's kind of to my point, you know, you can say that I'm a composer, but that really, you know, or that I'm composing, you know, as part of what I do, but that in itself involves so many aspects of musicianship that you want to develop. Now, you mentioned thin skin, which I was surprised, but that is true, exactly how you described it. But I also, you know, I just want to mention a little bit, you know, on the business side of trying to do that. You know, the one thing that I know from experience is that you know, there's you get rejected more often than you get accepted, especially early on. And so I think if from a business sense, you know, business tools, you've got to have that thick skin, and it sounds to me like you have to expect rejection to be part of the course. And I guess, you know, there's two ways to respond to that. You can say, well, it's just another rejection on to the next. But it sounds to me like you've tried to maybe learn from it, like, you know, find out, okay, what did you not like about this? And you've tried to make small improvements to the next thing you do. Would that be how you'd say?
Yeah, certainly. And you know, the unfortunate part is sometimes publishers will not give you a reason why.
Yeah.
Just, you know, a lot of times with some of these bigger publishers, they just get so many submissions, they'll just say it didn't work for us, or you know,
Have you ever had a publisher, because I have, that re you they never t this never contacted you? It's like, if you don't hear from us from, you know, in like 4 or 6 weeks, it says on our website, we probably didn't accept your work, and you never hear from them.
Yes, I have had that happen,
Yeah.
and I have found that I end up that to me is a huge turn off. And I think the publishers could do a better job of at least acknowledging
Yeah.
that they got the work and rejecting it. Because, you know, yes, I do think you need to have a thick skin, but I don't think you need to sell yourself short and
Right.
think that your music's not worthy of at least a response, you know.
Right.
I think the publishing industry could learn a thing or two about that. Now, the publishers that I work with, they all respond to me.
Yeah.
You know, I don't have a current publisher right now that I've ever sent a work with a line like, if you don't hear from us, then we didn't
Yeah.
accept your work. I just
Right.
I tend to feel that that is the publisher is kind of taking this attitude of, well, you can't do what you do without us, when in actuality the publisher can't do what they do without the composer.
Right.
You know?
Right.
So I don't think, very unfortunate way to do business.
Right.
And at the end of the day, if a publisher is going to take an interest in doing an all call for scores, they need to also have the ability to at least, even if it's a, you know, I've gotten the generic, thanks for your work. And then you can tell they put in bold print your piece, dear submitter or whatever.
Right.
At least then I know Okay, on to the next. Not did it even get to you? Because I've had some publishers like I've reached out like, hey, did you get this work? And they're like, no, we never got it. Could you please resend it? And then it ends up getting published. I'm like, what if I had never reached out? I would have been just in my head like, oh, you never they never responded, so I guess they didn't want it. When in actuality, they never even got it. So I think there is a little give and take that needs to happen. But most publishers they don't always offer feedback. But when I was first starting out and I got those emails, we didn't take your piece, I'd respond like, hey, thank you for reviewing my music. Is there anything you recommend that I do differently? Or what was there anything specific in the review that you found that would be beneficial to me as a composer? So I tried to make it, a learning experience, even as difficult as it was, because I was like, if I'm grumpy and run off, then my goal of publish is not going to happen, because I'm not going to know why it didn't happen. And I had Robert Sheldon. He wrote me back on a couple of things. I was like, well, they felt like your melodic ideas weren't as strong as some of the other pieces that were submitted. And I was like, okay, that is something tangible that I can work on, something more tuneful. Okay. Or it was the piece, they liked the piece, but they found it was a little difficult for what we were looking for. I was like, okay. That's something. Or it was a little too long, or they felt like it was scored a little, it was a little too heavy in some places. Or it's just like I've had some that's like, I have no idea why they didn't take it somewhere else, So those
Now,
happen too,
when it comes to getting pieces out there in as high a volume as you can, I kind of think like, well, if you're looking for a job or if you're looking for a college, it's a good strategy to just apply as many places at once. But correct me if I'm wrong, I think a lot of publishers say that by submitting this particular piece to us, you're not submitting it anywhere else until we've given you an approval or a rejection. So it sounds like what you could do is like if you went ahead and just wrote six choral pieces, eight choral pieces, whatever, you could send them all to different publishers if you wanted. And or you could I guess you could send them to the same publisher, but I don't know. I think I'm not sure how that would go, but
Yeah, you're less likely to have them all published by the same publisher all at once. I've had multiple pieces by one publisher in a given year, just because of the nature of how I was able to get the music out there. But I've gotten into a rhythm now where I write a piece, I finish the piece, I have a folder for either the commissioning party or if it's just something that I wanted to write on my own, and then I have a folder for here's the submission version of it. And I will, because I'll change the name of the file so that it's always the same. So it's very clear. Here's my name, here's the piece, grade level, or whatever it is, or whatever it's for. And then I have a subject line that I always do. I always say submission, colon, what the piece is, who the ensemble is. And then I've got my email that I send it out to. I always know which publisher I'm sending it to. And then once that's sent off, start writing the next piece. So I have a piece in review as I'm working on a piece. And then a lot of times depending on the time of year, sometimes I'll hear back within a week or two, sometimes it'll be months, whatever. And when I hear back, if it's a yes, awesome. Now I know what's next. We'll start editing, it'll get ready for production, writing program notes, getting things ready. If it's a rejection, I'll send it to the next place on my list. And I have this for every single piece. And sometimes I'll send it to, I might send it to Alfred first, or I'll send it to Excelsia first, or I'll send it to Shawnee Press first, just depending on what the piece is and what I think they might be looking for. But I'm always writing something, because when I was starting out, I'd write the piece and then send it off, and then I would wait. with bated breath. And
Yep.
I wouldn't write anything until I'd hear back. And then I'd hear back and it was rejected. And then I'd mourn and the
Yeah.
loss of this piece. And then I was like, man, I've spent 6 weeks not working on anything else. So
Yeah.
it's like I just send it off. I was like, okay, that's done. I'm gonna work on the next thing. I'm gonna be productive. I'm gonna write music. That's what I want to do at the end of the day. And so the years that I've had a lot of music come out, it's because I would send it off and the piece would be in review while I'm working on something else.
Yeah, I
And
think
I,
it
you know,
was
I.
I'm sorry, I think it was
Oh,
Stephen
go
King.
ahead.
I think it was Stephen King that said, for each successful author, by the time they have a new release come out, they're basically finishing up the next novel, and
Yeah.
it's ready to go through its process to be ready the next year,
That's true. Yeah,
Yep.
'cause you could send in a piece to be reviewed. So like right now is review season for 2024.
Yeah.
And the 2023 catalogs are coming out in a couple months. They're doing other recordings now, but I've gotten my call for scores from a couple publishers. So I've actually sent in a couple pieces already to be reviewed. If those, and those are pieces that I finished within the last few weeks. So maybe the end of 2022, I then sent in the music at the beginning of 2023. If it gets accepted, then it'll go into production and it won't go into print until this time, actually later, probably like April, May of 2024. So if you think about, okay, so there is 15, 16 months before the piece even came out, how much music have I written to then be ready to submit for the next year? So those first few years, I would like have a piece come out, and then maybe the next year I wouldn't have anything. And then the following year, maybe two pieces. And then I started to figure out the system. And okay, so this is when they're looking for scores. This is the process of getting it into print. And then I can be working on my next pieces for the next year in the time that it's taking to work on these other pieces. So like I'll be getting my proofs, or I've gotten a lot of my proofs for the music that's coming out already, but I've already sent in new stuff for the next year that I've just now finished.
Now the final aspect of business that I could think of is really important is if you get your pieces published but no one buys them, it's not really truly a success. So do the publishers you work with, do they take a big responsibility for that, or are the things that you have to do to sell your
I
music?
mean, that's great. I mean, I try to do as much as I can on my end as an individual, but I think the publishers, it is at the end of the day their job to promote the music. And that's why we give them the music to do with as they will. Because otherwise I would self-publish, you know. So I don't have the capabilities like Alfred. You know, they put these really nice color catalogs, and they professionally record everything, and then they send their catalogs to all the schools, and they have contacts with places all over the world to get this music out. Whereas, you know, I joke with people, it's like, what am I going to do with an orchestra piece? Am I going to go door to door and say, hey, you want to buy some orchestra music? You know, I mean, I have some contacts with some people, and it is easier with the internet, but it's still a lot of work to self-publish. It works for some people and they do a great job, and that's awesome, and they go for it. If you're a person who has that drive and is willing to travel and go out and work for it, go for it. But for me, I would rather write the music and have a publisher deal with it so that I could spend time writing more music or teaching than promoting my work. And because doing, you know, doing true promotion is a full-time job on its own. So if a piece doesn't do well, I sometimes find that it is Well, it could be a number of things. It could be that the publisher didn't push it enough. It got buried by another piece that was similar that year, or the piece just didn't hit the market in a meaningful way. There are a number of reasons why a piece might not do well. And I have had a few pieces that I thought would do really well that ended up not doing well. And I've had pieces that I'm like, I don't know if this is going to do very well. And then it does well. And it's like, I can't figure out the magic ball on that is always
And
something
I will
remains to
say,
be seen.
we haven't called out too many publishers, but I just say I have one piece with Alfred's, and as far as the internet goes, at least they will really help you, because if you type in the title of my piece in Google, it's page after page of like some
Yeah.
Japanese websites and Chinese websites. It's like all countries all over the world, where that distribute where you can get this
Right.
piece, you know. So
Yeah, that's true. I mean, they get the music out there, and I see performances from groups from all over the world. That I know for a fact that if I had self-published it, that just would not have happened. And I know, I have some pushback on that, where you can make more royalty wise per piece if you sell it yourself than going through a publisher. But for me, I mean, you're not going to make a lot of money regardless. It's just not a huge money maker unless, like you said before, you're a John Adams or Don Corleano type. And really, really just get hundreds and thousands of performances every year of your music. But I do find that, I mean, I have a lot of performances every year that, I mean, I have directors from all over the country that I'm in contact with now, that otherwise there would have been no way for us to have been in touch.
And those con
I found videos of on YouTube of performances, and I end up reaching out to the directors and just thanking them for performing the works,
yeah.
which has been a great way to connect as well.
And those contacts through publication, or at least potential commissions down the road, which is where you can make some pretty good income,
Right. That's true. Yeah, the commissions are where you can really make it work. And I found that being published through commercial publications has made the it, I hate using this term, but I'm going to do it anyway. It kind of legitimizes what I do,
I was gonna
you
say
know?
prestigious,
Yeah, right. But you know, there is that view from, and I've found it myself when I've talked with directors when I was first starting out, like, I'd love to write your group a piece, and okay, that's nice. What do you have? And I'm like, well, here's something I worked on, and it's like me, and I printed it out on my inkjet, and it's like nothing. Versus now I can say, hey, here's some professional recordings on Alfred's website, and they're like, oh, wow, okay. Well, yeah, we might be interested in commissioning you to do a piece, because they've got something tangible and professional that they can listen to and look at, and that they're comfortable with because they've bought from those publishers before. So they know, oh, well, if they've taken you on as a composer, then it must be good somewhere. So yeah, we'll take a chance on you. And so I've found that to help kind of seal the deal, whereas otherwise I don't know that it would have happened. Now, that's not to say that that isn't always the case, because I know some composers, they have success outside of that. That's been my experience.
I guess the last category of tools is what are some of your tools of the trade? What kind of technology do you use for as a composer?
Well, since I was young, and I started with Finale version 3. It was a floppy disk, and I've stuck with it because that's what I know. A lot of my publishers use Finale, so that works really well for me. I know some composers use Sibelius, and that's great. I've tried it. I don't know how to use it, because it's not something I ever use. So I can make a score look really, really nice in Finale. using, you know, what I know from the, gosh, 20 plus years that I've been using it.
Yeah.
Getting on into 30 plus years.
Right.
Finale's my big go-to. I have used Logic Pro to do some recording. I don't do a ton of recording,
Right.
but when I do have to do some, I've used Logic, because I've got my Mac,
Yeah.
and I've done that.
And your
I have
voice memo
a
app. Right.
and my voice memo app. Yeah, that is very, very helpful.
Yep.
I have a Hawaii concert artist keyboard, and I use that to practice for performances, and I also use it to input my music into Finale or Logic. It can do both, and so it's really nice to have the ability to have one instrument do all of those things. Because I know a lot of composer friends, they have the nice drawer with the MIDI controller that's full size. But and I, you know, I thought about going that route, but I was like, you know, as a pianist, I want to be able to use that piano to also practice and feel
Yeah.
like I'm getting a good instrument that I can work with, but it needs to be digital as well. So I went the Kauai route so that it's digital, feels, because they use wooden keys,
Yeah.
it feels like as real as a digital keyboard can feel, but then also expedite writing into Finale, because I can just play
Right.
the notes versus the pointing and clicking, which takes a
Right.
long time.
Right.
I did that for years, the
Yeah.
pointing and clicking.
Yeah.
I got pretty good at it, but then I'm glad that I don't have to do that anymore.
Yeah. Just, since it's not something that we're going to focus on too much, I will shout out another podcast. It's also a blog, and you may know about it. It's called Scoring Notes.
Okay.
They cover all the major ones. They cover Finale, Sibelius, Dorico, and sometimes they get people to come on, like, here's 20 shortcut tips or something you should know about this. And like,
Yeah.
there's some ones I didn't know about. Like, I had no idea about, on the simple tool, it's called repitch. And it's like, as soon as I discovered, like, so if you've got, say, a rhythm pattern that continues the measure, but the notes are changing, you can copy and paste the whole thing, and then take the repitch and just change the notes, but it'll keep the rhythm, ties included, all the way
Oh.
across. And it's like, wow, this is so much faster. And there's several tips like that, and that they have, and they have a podcast. It used to be once a week, and now it's a little less regular than that,
Okay,
but their
I'll have
blog
to check
comes
it
out
out.
once a week. Yeah, Scoring Notes. I would definitely subscribe to the blog, because it'll include links to the podcast when they do one, and just
Yeah.
some great stuff on there. But I also thought, we're gonna wrap up here in just a moment, but we could have gone a completely different conversation with my other podcast, for those who know Life in the Pit, because we did meet as a result of musical
Yes,
theater. You
that's true.
played, I played third keyboard, you played second, but you also did the reduced orchestration, a
Yes, that's
specific
right.
arrangement for a chorus line. And I guess it was, no, it wasn't junior, it was like a chorus line, but they,
It was the full thing.
yep. Yeah, that was a very fun experience. But it's a di different story for different podcasts sometimes,
Sure,
perhaps.
yeah. Also use Finale for that one.
Yeah. Where can people find your music if they're interested, for their organization or for themselves? And if you wish to share, where can people follow you?
The best place since I have a lot of different publishers, I've got it all on my website. It's BruceWTippett.com. Tippett is TippeE.
Right.
You can go to Google and do Bruce Tippett, and you'll probably find it. There aren't a lot of Tippetts,
Right.
to begin with, and then the Tippett with the E on the end is
Yeah.
even more rare. So,
Yeah.
but it's all right there. Facebook is probably the best place to get in touch with me if you want to chat. I have Instagram as well, but you know, if you do the messenger on there, I can get back with you. If you go to my website, there's an email. It's just bruce@brucewtippett.com. You can send me an email. It goes right to my phone, and I usually try to respond pretty quickly, unless I've got babies with me or singing songs.
All right.
So yeah.
Well, thanks so much for your time.
Thank you so much for having me. This has been a blast.
And that concludes episode 4 and my conversation with Bruce. And just want to remind you, if you're watching this on YouTube, thank you. Please make sure that you've liked this video and that you're subscribing. And if you're listening to this podcast, wherever you get your podcasts, again, thank you for listening. And I just ask if you haven't already, if you would please be so generous to leave a 5-star rating and a review. And if you don't feel like you can do that, in all sincerity, if you did enjoy this episode, I would ask that you share it with at least one other person who you think might enjoy this episode. And thank you for listening. My name is David Lane. You can find me and the podcast on social media, Instagram and TikTok at David Lane Music, on Facebook at David M. Lane Music, and of course on YouTube at David Lane Music 1. One word, David Lane Music 1. I'll of course be back with you next Monday, but I think I'm going to be back with you before then. I've got a short episode that kind of leads into my next interview, so watch out for that. That'll probably be Thursday or Friday. That'll be episode number 5, and then I'll be back with you right after that with episode number 6. Thank you for listening.